Hey friends, it's another episode of Azure Friday. I'm here with Aravind Krishna, and we're talking about some common design patterns that you might find when you're working with Azure Cosmos DB. How are you, sir?
Good. Thanks for having me, Scott.
My pleasure. So what do you have for me today?
So Cosmos DB makes it really easy to build scalable applications. So your data can grow seamlessly in terms of storage and throughput. You don't have to worry about schema. You don't have to worry about indexing. So all that's good, right? So a lot of these problems, or like the models that we see, application patterns, they tend to fit a few common themes and patterns. So in this session, I just want to walk through, maybe start with the vanilla use case, and then we look at a few exceptions to the rule. So I want to stress these are exceptions only to use in case you run into certain kinds of issues.
Okay.
So things like, you know, how do you handle SKUs? How do you handle a workload which is mostly writes? So we just look at it case by case and walk through code to see how to go through it.
Sounds like a plan.
So let me walk through. So this is in GitHub. I mean, all of these samples are out there. These are mostly snippets to illustrate all of these patterns.
Okay.
So before we jump into it, I just want to summarize the quick key concepts that become the guiding principles in terms of these patterns, why you adopt them.
Okay.
First is documents in Cosmos DB are freeform JSON. If you had schema, the only schema is they should have a primary key. And that's a combination of partition key and row key.
Okay.
Good. Now, the documents stay within collections. These are the containers. And each of these collections must have a partition key definition. So that's the property that you use for scaling out data.
Okay.
They have an optional indexing policy. By default, everything is indexed, but you can turn it off if you know what queries you want to go for. There's automatic expiration. So if you have time series data, you can set expiration windows. You can set unique key constraints.
Mm-hmm.
And this is an important part. Collections are scaled out across partitions. And each of these partitions, you can think of it as a server, and it hosts a range of partition keys.
Mm.
So this becomes important when you think about how your workload would scale out effectively.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in terms of operations, it's a simple set of basic primitives of operations. So you have the CRUD operations, your REST API, GET, POST, PUT, and DELETE. You have SQL queries, so that's your single partition query as well as a cross partition query.
Mm-hmm.
You have some stored procedures within the scope of a partition that let you do things like bulk operations. And you have read, feed, and change feed. So this is your set of toys.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at the principles that you see in all of these patterns, is if you're trying to go from most efficient to the most expensive, the order pretty much goes GET, which is your point read, your single partition query, your cross partition query, and then lastly a scan query that goes over read feed.
Oh, interesting. Okay, so to put that in the context of a SQL person's brain, because I'm an old SQL person, scan query like a table scan. If you end up having to look at every single row to answer a question, that's going to be more expensive than a simple straight GET by ID or a known index.
Correct. Correct.
Okay,
correct.
That makes sense.
And you know, the same policies apply, right? Like just like a relational database, bulk insert is better than POST, which is an insert, which is better than a replace, which is a little more heavyweight.
Okay.
And lastly, if I could summarize, one takeaway would be you should use change feed more.
Okay, and maybe you could speak a little bit about that, using change feed and why that's important.
Yeah, so I can go through the specific examples, but
great.
The benefit is it's incremental data, right?
Mm.
So instead of running query over a large data set, you're working off of the deltas. And that lets you do a lot of work at write time so that reads are inexpensive. So that becomes a very scalable, distributed kind of a pattern.
Cool.
So let's look at vanilla use case, right? So this is like your simplest use case. So we have players, and let's say you're building a gaming app, and you have user player profiles, and you want to look up by player. The APIs that you want to implement are get player by ID, add player, remove player, update player, right?
Mm-hmm. All for an individual player, and you'd be doing it probably within the scope of that player. They would log in, and you'd call those queries and learn about that one person. And those would be very fast, right?
Those would be very fast. And the beauty of it is, I mean, so this is our player class, right? ID, name, handle, high score, pretty simple class. And this, the beauty of this is this code, whatever you write, this will work for hundreds of players or billions of players. You just need to scale out your Cosmos DB throughput.
And just to be clear, you said billions and you're not joking.
Yeah, for sure. Billions. I wish I could go further, but I mean, billions is how many
Cosmos
people
DB
we have.
Cosmos DB has been known to scale, to world scale.
Yeah, for sure. So this is your simplest case, right?
Mm-hmm.
So let's say you have, in this case, you need to come up with a partition key. Mm-hmm. And we know it's all key-based access, so your partition key could be the ID. And this is perfectly fine. I would say the straw man for most of your partitioning, partition key selection is ID, because that's the simplest and gives you great distribution of writes
mm-hmm.
across partitions, so you get seamless scale out. And also read access, if it's by key, then it works.
And is ID, forgive my ignorance, but is ID always a GUID, or is it always unique, or is it always a monotonically increasing number? Is it something you decide?
You get to decide. And what this database provides is the ID is guaranteed to be unique. So we have constraints on the database side. The combination of partition key and ID is unique, but if you set ID to partition key, then that value alone is unique.
Okay.
So in this case, we know it's just key value access, so why not turn indexing off? Because that will give you a few more RUs back in terms of indexing. Not for this document maybe, but it certainly gives you a big impact if you have big documents.
Okay.
So if you look at get player, it's just a wrapper around read document async. So this was our first point, use get over query,
mm-hmm.
because that is, you know, you don't even have to compile SQL, it's just a straight REST call. Add player, I mean, you can use upsert, which is like the atomic create or insert or update.
Mm-hmm.
Remove is again a delete. Now for update, if you look at the pattern, it's a little bit more interesting. You have to do a conditional update with an etag. So you read the etag back, and you know if it's the same as what you had read previously, then you apply the update to the document. And this gives you that benefit of not locking. The optimistic concurrency lets you scale out effectively for items that infrequently change.
Now, I don't see, there's no if explicitly here. It's built within that access condition.
Correct. So you see the access condition it says if match,
that is a
request
then
option. And you're
passing that condition into this request object. So it's an implied if, you just can't see it.
Correct. So that's your simple vanilla case, right? So if you look at it, this is pretty much the simplest case, and I mean, a lot of use cases fit within this bucket.
Mm-hmm.
Now let's get a little bit more complicated. What if you have hierarchy?
Mm-hmm.
So if you have players, and players have games, so you have 1-to-n parent-child relationship.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not all that much more complicated as well. So in this case, you have, let's look at our repository class. It's over the same data set, but what I do is I set player ID as my partition key.
Mm-hmm.
And this means I can get all of the data for a player. So if I wanted to implement a get game async, then I just pass in my player ID and game ID, and then again I can do a get.
Mm-hmm.
And similarly, if I want to find all of the games for the player, I know that this is, for example, a link query where I say player ID equals player ID. So this is again a SQL query that's sent to the backend, and it's still scoped to a single partition key.
Mm-hmm.
So that's also efficient. So that one was not that much more complicated, right? So if you have 1-to-n, the key is, you know, if you have that hierarchy, you want to take the parent of the hierarchy, make it your partition key.
Mm-hmm.
And here again, we stick to single partition queries as well as the REST primitives, the CRUD primitives.
Mm-hmm.
So this is going to scale really well. Now let's get into the exceptions. What do you do when you have M2n hierarchies? The idea being, you know, if you have a multiplayer game, it's a popular viral game, then it's not really the parent-child relationship, so you want to find by player, find by game ID.
Yeah.
So the methods you need are get player by ID, get game by ID, add game, remove game, right? So that gets a little bit tricky.
Mm-hmm.
So let me walk you through our same repository if we were to extend this.
Yeah, I'm seeing a lot of games now where they have 100 people on an island.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got hundreds of players playing hundreds of games, and you have to manage all of their state.
Yeah. It's a fun problem.
Yeah.
So in this case, the simplest thing is, you know, we have one collection. Let's start with one collection.
Mm-hmm.
Here, again, because we are explicitly controlling indexes, because my goal was showing how to get the best performance, you have indexes both on player ID and game ID.
Mm-hmm.
Get game by player ID is simple. That we just saw that earlier. It was a partition key query.
Right.
Now, what about get by game ID? Now, notice it's not a partition key, right? So what you do here is, if it's infrequent, this is a big if.
Okay.
Usually, if we have some kind of a Pareto where most requests are by player ID and infrequent are by game ID, then you can go do a cross-partition query.
Mm-hmm. But do you have to decide what infrequent means to you? Like infrequent, you said if it's infrequent, what's infrequent? Daily?
I would say, you know, if it's a 90-10 mix,
or,
you know, roughly speaking.
Not
it's
often.
It's a thumb rule.
Okay.
Not often. Yeah.
That makes sense.
But what if it's often? In some cases, you might have, they might be a 50-50 mix, right?
Right.
This is where you have change feed to the rescue.
Mm.
So let's say you wanted another pivot of the same collection, mm-hmm. which has game ID as your partition key. So you would have a clone of this collection which has a different partition key. And let's say you have the same data that is now you can perform lookups against game ID, right? This problem is solved. The partition key lookup problem is solved. But how do you populate this data?
Yeah, and you said a clone. Do I have to keep this up to date? Which one's the authoritative source?
Correct. Double writes, the evils of double writes. Like what happens, one fails, the other succeeds, right? The change feed gives you that deterministic hook to keep track of changes as they come in. So mm-hmm. you can always, you know, you have failure recovery. You have scale out, for example, if you can throw a bunch of worker nodes at it. They can do load balancing, things of that nature. So this is the bare bones change feed API, right? So if you look at partition key ranges, like the way this works is like you have actual direct access to the key ranges of partition keys, and you can retrieve changes from those partitions independently. The beauty of this is now, for example, I can throw multiple workers on it, and I can run this in parallel and drain all of the changes that come in. Ultimately, the code that works here is essentially a single absurd document async that goes and takes all of the changes from the source
mm-hmm.
and applies it to the destination. If you were, for example, using Azure Functions or Spark Streaming,
right.
Some of the higher level primitives, essentially you just have to write that one for loop without all of the wrapper code.
Is there a concern that I might be in a for loop that has millions?
The beauty of it, it's once, right?
Okay.
So reads are cheaper than writes, and you're doing this work exactly once. And once you have the data cooked up, the fact that reads are efficient more than pays for that cost.
Mm-hmm.
And then of course, you know, and this shows you like, you know, when you're getting game, you're just getting getting a game by its own ID.
Mm-hmm.
So if you look at another more complicated example, and this is very common, is time series data, right? And the problem or like the challenge there is no natural key. I mean, it's tempting to use time as the key, but that naturally leads to hotspots within your application.
Mm.
So how do you handle time series data? And here is essentially the trick to it is finding something that has a wide range of values. So if you look at look at my repo. What I'm doing over here is I'm essentially using sensor ID as my partition key.
Mm-hmm.
And what this means is if I have a number of sensors, they can continue to use the full throughput and they can all continue to write at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
The flip side is when you're doing queries, you would have to read it across all of these partitions,
right?
But that's okay because you know I have an index on the time range information within each partition.
Mm-hmm.
Now, to extend the same idea of change feed, what you want to do is you have data that is raw data, and if you want to take the raw data, let's say you've seen this in the Azure portal as well, right? Like you have data that's organized by minute,
mm-hmm.
and then you have data that's rolled up. And it's a summarized aggregate over hour, for example, and then day, and so on. And the benefit of this is you care about high precision within your recent time windows, but you only care about roll-ups at the longer time windows. And you can build that exact same time window-based aggregation using change feed.
Where is this repository that so people can go and look at all these samples?
So this is in GitHub. If you go take a look at GitHub under our .NET samples.
Mm-hmm. So we have github.com/Azure, And under Azure DocumentDB.net, you've got samples, and literally everything you've got right here as you have it is there available. So all the source code, we hide nothing.
Yeah, we hide nothing. And of course, there are more interesting cases to all of these, how to handle cases where you have large documents, large keys. So it illustrates, you know, the various trade-offs, the patterns that you can use. Of course, there is a ton of documentation and samples aside from this as well in this repository.
Mm-hmm. I wish we could talk for an hour more. There's so much great information and so much great resources available to you to learn how to use Azure Cosmos DB and the DocumentDB features in it. And make sure you check out that GitHub repository. All of the samples that Aravind showed are available to you. And I learned a lot today on Azure Friday. Thank you.